credentials, Lord Illiwell. I know she thinks that I am not well educated enough to be your secretary. She is perfectly right to post fearfully either at school and pass the examination now to save my life.
Oh, my dear Gerald, examinations are of no value whatsoever. If a man is a gentleman, he knows quite enough already. And if he's not a gentleman, whatever he knows is bad for him.
But I am so ignorant of the world.
Don't be afraid, Gerald. Remember, you have on your side the most fascinating thing in the world. Youth. The middle-aged are mortgaged to life. The old are in life's lumber room. But youth is the lord of life. To win back my youth, Gerald, there's nothing I wouldn't do. Except exercise, get up early, and be a useful member of the community.
You don't think yourself old, Lord Illiwell?
I am old enough to be your father, Gerald.
I never knew my father.
He died years ago. So Lady Hudson told me. It's very curious.
Mother never talks to me about my father. Sometimes I think she must have married beneath her.
Really? You must have missed not having a father, I suppose, Gerald.
Oh, no. Mother's been so good to me. No one has ever had such a mother as I have.
No, I'm quite sure of that. Still, I should imagine mothers don't really understand their sons. Don't realise, I mean, a son has ambitions, a desire to see life, to make himself a name. After all, you can't be expected to pass all your life in such a hopeless rocket, now, can you?
Well, no, it would be dreadful.
I mean, a mother's love is very touching, but it can be curiously selfish.
I suppose it is.
Your mother is a thoroughly good woman. Good women have such limited views on life. Their interests can seem so petty, can't they?
They are awfully interested in things that we don't care much about.
Your mother is intensely religious, I suppose.
She's always going to church.
Ah, she is not modern. And to be modern now is the only thing worth being these days. You want to be modern, don't you, Gerald? Well, what you have to do at present is simply to fit yourself for the best society. The man who can dominate a London dinner table can dominate the world. The future belongs to the dandy. It's the exquisites who are going to rule.
I would like to wear nice clothes awfully, but I've always been told that a man should not think about his clothes too much.
Oh. People are so superficial nowadays that they don't understand the philosophy of the superficial. By the way, Joe, you really should learn how to tie your tie better. Sentiments all very well for a buttonhole. The essential thing with a necktie is style. A well-tied tie is the first serious step in life.
I'm sure I can learn to tie a tie, Lord Illiwell, but I should never learn to speak as you do. I don't know how to talk.
Oh, talk to every woman as though you loved her, and every man as though he bored you. And by the end of your first season, you shall have the reputation for possessing the most perfect social tact.
But it's very difficult to get into society, isn't it?
To get into the best society nowadays, you have to feed people, amuse people, or shock people, that is all.
I suppose society is wonderfully delightful.
Well, to be in society is merely a bore, but to be out of it is simply a tragedy. Society is a necessary thing. No man has any real success in this world unless he has got women to back him, and women rule society. If you haven't got women on your side, you're quite over. You might just as well be a barrister, or a stockbroker, or a journalist.
It's very difficult to understand women, is it not?
Oh, would you never try to understand them, Joe? No. Women are pictures. Men are problems. If you want to understand what a woman really means, which, by the way, is always a really dangerous thing to try and do. Look at her and listen to her.
But women are awfully clever, aren't they?
Oh, one should always tell them so. Oh, but to the philosopher, my dear Gerald, women represent the triumph of matter over mind, just as men represent the triumph of mind over morals.
How then can women have as much power as you say they have?
The history of women is the history of the worst form of tyranny the world's ever known, the tyranny of the weak over the strong.
But don't women have a refining influence?
No, nothing refines but the intellect.
But there are good women in society, aren't there?
Oh, to certainly not tell them so, or they might not become good at once. Women are a fascinatingly willful sex. Every woman is a rebel, and usually wildly revolts against herself.
You've never been married, have you, Lady Mother? Oh.
Men marry because they are tired, women because they are curious. Both disappointed.
You don't think one can be happy if one's married?
Oh, perfectly happy. The happiness of a married man depends very much on the people he has not married.
And if one is in love?
Oh, one should always be in love. That's the reason why one should never marry.
Love is a wonderful thing, isn't it?
When one is in love, one begins by deceiving oneself, and one ends by deceiving others. And that's what the world calls a romance. But a really grand passion is comparatively rare nowadays. It's the privilege of people who've got nothing to do. And the only possible explanation for us Harfords.
Harfords, Lord Lillian?
Yes, that is my family name. You should study the peerage, Gerald. It's the only book a young man about town should know thoroughly. And the best thing in fiction the English have ever done. And now you're going to enter a perfectly new life with me, and I want you to know how to live.
Ah, you are, Lord Illingworth. Well, I suppose you've been telling Gerald about what his new duties are to me, and giving him a great deal of good advice.
Oh, I've been giving the very best advice, Lady Hudson.
I'm so sorry I was not here to listen to it, but then I suppose I'm too old to learn now. Except from you, dear Archdeacon. But then I always know when you're in your nice pulpit, then I always know what you're going to say. So I don't feel alarmed. Oh, Mrs. Arbuthnot, do come and join us. Gerald has been having such a nice long chat with Lord Illingworth. You must feel very flattered at the wonderful situation he's got now. Let us sit down. And tell me, how is your beautiful embroidery going on?
I'm always at work.
Mrs. Daubeny embroiders a little, does she not?
She was very deft with her needle once, right to Dorcas, but the gout has crippled her fingers a good deal, and she has not touched the tambour frame for 9 or 10 years. But she has many other amusements. She is very much interested in her own health.
Ah, that is always a nice distraction, is it not? Lord Illingworth, what are you talking about?
I was on the point of explaining to Gerald that the world has always laughed at its tragedies, that being the only way to be able to bear them, and that consequently, whatever the world has treated as serious, belongs to the comedy side of things.
Ah, now I am quite out of my depth. I usually am when Lord Illingworth says anything. And the Humane Society never, excuse me, I am left to drown, to sink. I have a dim idea, Lord Illingworth, that you are usually on the side of sinners, and I know I would try to be on the side of the saints, but that is as far as I get. And after all, it may be merely the fancy of a drowning person.
And the only difference between a saint and a sinner well, it's that every saint has a past, and every sinner has a future.
Oh, that quite does for me now. Oh, you and I, Mrs. Arbuthnot, are behind the age. We can't follow Lord Illingworth. Nowadays, to have been well brought up is a great disadvantage. It shuts one out from so much.
I should be sorry to follow Lord Illingworth in any of his opinions.
Oh, that is quite right, dear. Jane. Well, oh, you needn't be anxious about him, dear. I saw him some time ago with Lady Stutfield in the yellow drawing room. They seem very happy together. Oh, you're not going, Caroline. Please sit down.
I think I had better go and look after John.
It doesn't do to pay men so much attention. And Caroline has really nothing to be anxious about. Lady Stutfield is so sympathetic. She has a beautiful nature. Oh, here is Sir John and Mrs. Anne, me too. Sir John, Caroline has been looking everywhere for you.
We've been waiting for her in the music room, Lady Hudson.
The music room? I thought it was the yellow drawing room. so defective. Oh, Mrs. Daubeny has a wonderful memory, has she not?
She used to be quite remarkable for her memory. But since her last attack, she recalls chiefly the events of her early childhood. But she takes great pleasure in such retrospections. Great pleasure.
Ah, Lady Stanfield. And what has Mr. Kelville been talking to you about?
About bimetallism, as well as I remember.
Bimetallism, is that quite a nice subject? But then I know people talk very freely about everything nowadays. Oh, Mrs. Allenby, what has the John been talking to you about?
About Patagonia.
Really? Very remote topic. Looks, I suppose, quite improving.
He has been most interesting on the subject of Patagonia. Savages seem to have quite the same views as cultured people on almost all subjects. They are excessively advanced.
Really? What do they do?
Apparently, everything.
Well, dear Archdeacon, it is very gratifying, is it not? To find that the world is the same world.
The world is merely divided into two classes. Those who believe the incredible, like the public, and those who do the improbable.
Like yourself?
Yes. Yes, I'm always astonishing myself. It's the only thing that makes life worth living.
And what have you been doing lately that astonishes you?
Oh, I've been finding all sorts of beautiful qualities in my own nature.
I don't know how it is, Lord Illingworth, but everything you have said tonight seems to me excessively immoral. It has been most interesting listening to you.
All thought is immoral. If you think of anything, you kill it. Nothing survives being thought.
Now I don't understand a word of that, but I suppose it is quite true. Personally, I have very little to reproach myself with on the subject of thinking. Women should think as they should do all things. In moderation.
No, moderation is a fatal thing, Lady Hunsdon. Nothing succeeds like excess.
I hope I shall remember that. But I'm beginning to forget everything nowadays. It is a great misfortune.
Oh. It is one of your most fascinating qualities, Lady Hunsdon. No woman should have a memory. Memory in a woman is the beginning of dowdiness. One can always tell from the size of her bonnet whether
how charming you are, Lord Illingworth. You have the most comforting views on life.
Dr. Daubeny's cab.
Oh, my dear Archdeacon, it is only 10:30.
Oh, I am afraid I must be going, Lady Hunsdon. Tuesday is always one of Mrs. Daubeny's bad nights.
Oh, well, I mustn't keep you from her. I told Barker to put a brace of partridge in the carriage. Mrs. Daubeny may fancy them.
Mrs. Daubeny never eats solids now. Lives entirely on jellies. But she is wonderfully cheerful. She has nothing to complain of.
There is a beautiful moon tonight.
Let us go and look at it. To look at anything as inconstant nowadays is wonderful.
You have the looking glass.
Oh, it is unkind. It merely shows me my wrinkles.
Mine is much better. It never tells me the truth.
Well, then it is in love with you.
May I come too?
I do, my dear boy.
Gerald!
What, Mother?
It is getting late. Let us go home.
Mother, do let us wait a bit longer. Lord Illingworth is delightful. Besides, my wife has surprised me. We're starting for India at the end of the month.
Let us go home.
If you really want to, certainly. But I must bid goodbye to Lord Illingworth first. I'll be back in 5 minutes.
Let him leave me if he chooses. But not with him. I couldn't bear it.
What a lovely night it is, Mrs. Obama.
Is it?
Mrs. Obama, I do wish you would let us be friends. You're so different from the other women here. When you came into the drawing room this evening, You brought with you a sense of what is good and pure in this life. I've been foolish. There are things that are right to say that can be said at the wrong time to the wrong people.
I heard what you said, Miss Worthley. I agree with it.
I didn't know that you had heard me, but I knew that you would agree with me. A woman who has sinned should be punished, should she not?
Yes.
She shouldn't be allowed into the society of good men and women.
She should not.
And the man should be punished in the same way.
In the same way. And the children, if there are children, in the same way also?
Yes. It is right that the sins of the parents be visited on the children. It is a just law. It is God's law.
It is one of God's terrible laws.
You're distressed by your son leaving you, so I'm not.
Yes.
Do you like him going away with Lord Illingworth? Of course, his position, no doubt, and money, but position and money are not everything, are they?
They are nothing. They bring misery.
Then why do you let your son go with him?
Oh, he wishes it himself.
But if you asked him to stay, he would he not?
He has set his heart on going.
He couldn't refuse you anything. He loves you too much. Ask him to stay. Let me send him in to you. I heard him on the terrace at this moment. I heard him with Miss Lord Illingworth. They will laugh because I pass you the music room.
Don't trouble, Miss Worthley. I can wait. It is of no consequence.
No. I'll tell him to come to you. Do. Do ask him to stay.
He won't come. I know he won't come.
Dear mother, I'm afraid I've kept you waiting. I've thought all about it.
Oh, I am so happy tonight, mother. I've never been so happy.
At the prospect of going away?
Don't say that, mother. Of course I'd be sorry to leave you. Well, you are the best mother in the whole world. But as Lord Illingworth says, it is impossible for a man to stay in such a place as Rockley. You don't mind it, but I'm ambitious. I want to do something more than that. I want to be Lord Illingworth's secretary, and he's going to help me. He's going to do everything for me.
Gerald, don't go away with Lord Illingworth. I implore you not to. Gerald, I beg you.
Mother, how changeable you are. An hour and a half ago in the drawing room, you agreed to the whole thing. Now you turn around and make objections, stand in the way of my one chance in life. I find it very curious that when I have such a wonderful piece of good luck, the one person who should put difficulties in my way is my own mother. Besides, mother, you know I love Hester Worsley. And if I had a position, if I had prospects, if I were Lord Illingworth's secretary, I could ask Hester to be my wife. As a wretched bankrupt of 100 a year, it would be an impertinence.
I fear you need have no hopes of Miss Worsley. I know her views on life. She has just told them to me.
Well, I have my ambition left at any rate. You have always tried to crush my ambition, haven't you, Mother? You told me that the world is a wicked place, that success isn't worth having, that society is shallow. Well, I don't believe it. You've been wrong in all that you have taught me, Mother. Quite wrong. Lord Illingworth is a fashionable man. He's a successful man. I would give anything to be just like Lord Illingworth.
I should sooner see you dead.
What is your objection with Lord Illingworth? Tell me outright, what is it?
He is a bad man.
In what way bad? I don't understand what you mean.
I will tell you.
I suppose you think him bad because he doesn't believe in the same things as you do. Well, men are different to women, Mother. It is only natural that they should have different views.
It is not what Lord Illingworth believes or what he does not believe that makes him a bad man. It is what he is.
Is it something you know? Something you actually know?
It is something I know.
Something you are quite sure of?
Quite sure of.
And how long have you known?
For over 20 years.
Is it fair to go back over 20 years in any man's career? Besides, what do you or I have to do with Lord Illingworth's early life? What business is it of ours?
What this man has been, he is now, and will be always.
Mother,
Tell me what Lord Illingworth did. If it was anything shameful, I will not go away with it. Surely you know me well enough for that.
Gerald, come and sit near to me, as you used to do when you were a little boy. Gerald, there was a girl once. She was very young. George Harford, that was Lord Illingworth's name then, George Harford met her. She knew nothing about life. He knew everything. He made this girl love him so much that she left her father's house with him. He had solemnly promised to marry her, and she had believed him. She was very young and ignorant of what life really is. He put the marriage off from month to month. Trusted in him all the while. She loved him. Before her child was born, for there was a child, she implored him for the child's sake to marry her, that the child might have a name, that her sin might not be visited on the child who was innocent. He refused. After her child was born, she left him, taking the child away with her, and her life was ruined. And all that was sweet and good and pure in her ruined also. She suffered terribly. She suffers now. For her there is no joy, no peace, no atonement. She is a lost soul. That is why I call Lord Illingworth a bad man. That's why I don't want my boy to be with him.
Mother. It sounds all very tragic, of course. But I dare say the girl was as much to blame as Lord Illingworth. Besides, with a nice girl, no girl with any nice feelings at all, run away from her home with a man whom she was not married, then live with him as her wife. No nice girl would.
Gerald, I withdraw all of my objections. You're at liberty to go away with Lord Illingworth when and where you choose.
Dear mother, I knew you wouldn't stand in my way. You're the best mother God ever made. And as for Lord Illingworth, I don't believe he is capable of anything infamous or base. I can't believe it of him. I can't.
Let me go! Let me go!
Lord Illingworth, you have insulted the woman I love most in the world. If there is a God in heaven, I'll kill you.
No!
Don't hold me, I'll kill him.
Let
him go, mother.
Stop, Gerald, stop. He is your own father.
Lord Illingworth says that all influence is bad, that good influence is the worst in the world.
can change his mind. I'm certainly bringing him here.
I should like to see Lord Illingworth in a happy English home.
It would do him so much good, dear. Too many women nowadays in London seem to furnish their rooms with nothing but orchids and foreigners and French novels. But here we have the room of a sweet scent. Fresh, natural flowers, books that don't shock one, and pictures that one can look at without blushing.
But I like blushing.
Well, there is a good deal to be said for blushing. Poor dear Hunsdon used to say I didn't blush nearly enough. But then he was so very particular. He wouldn't let me know any of his men friends, except those who were over 70.
I delight men over 70. They always offer one the devotion of a lifetime. I think 70 an ideal age for a man.
Oh, she is quite incorrigible, is she not, Gerald? I do hope your dear mother will come and visit me more often now. You and Lord Illingworth start almost immediately.
I've given up my intention of being Lord Illingworth's secretary.
Oh, surely not, Gerald. What reason can you have?
I don't think I'd be suitable for the post.
I wish Lord Illingworth would ask me to be his secretary. But he says I'm not serious enough.
Oh, my dear, you mustn't talk like that in this house. Mrs. Arbuthnot doesn't know anything about the wicked society in which we all live. She won't go into it. I consider that it was a great honor coming to me last night. It gave the party quite an air of respectability.
Yes, that must have been what you thought was thunder in the air.
My dear, there is no resemblance at all. But what do you mean, Gerald, by not being suitable?
Lord Illingworth's views of life and mine are too different.
But Gerald, at your age, you shouldn't have any views on life. You should be guided by others. Lord Illingworth has made you the most flattering offer. Travelling with him would see the world, or at least as much of it as one ought to see, and staying with the right people, which is so important.
I don't want to see the world. I've seen enough of it.
I hope you don't think you've exhausted life, Mr. Arbuthnot. When a man says that, one knows life has exhausted him.
Don't wish to leave my mother.
Oh, Gerald, that is pure laziness on your part. If I were your mother, I would insist on your going.
Mrs. Arbuthnot compliments my lady, but she has a bad headache and cannot see anyone this morning.
A bad headache. I am so sorry, Gerald. But perhaps you can bring her up to Hunsdon's afternoon if she's feeling better.
Not this afternoon, Lady Hunsdon.
Well, tomorrow then. Ah, Gerald, if only you had a father, he wouldn't let you waste your life here. He would make sure that you went away with Lord Illingworth. But we mothers are too weak, all heart. Come, dear, I must go along to the rectory now and inquire after Mrs. Dawley. Is far from well. It's wonderful how the Archdeacon bears up, really. He is the most sympathetic of husbands. Well, goodbye, Gerald. Give my fondest love to your mother.
Goodbye.
Goodbye,
Mr. Oh, Gerald, we're going to take a shortcut through your pretty garden. Now, remember what I've said. Start at once with Lord Illingworth.
Au revoir, Mr. Arbuthnot. Mind you bring me back something from your travels. Not an Indian shawl. On no account, an Indian shawl.
What name can I sign? I who have no right to any name. Mother. Father, I have written to him.
To whom?
To my father. I have written to tell him to come here at 4 o'clock this afternoon.
He shall not come here. He shall not cross the threshold of my house.
Well, then he must come. You don't understand. You don't understand.
Nothing in the world
would induce me to go away from Lord Illingworth. All
or to leave you. No, I've written to him to say that...
What can you have to say to him?
Can't you guess what I have written in his letter?
No.
Sure you can. Think, my lord, what must happen now at once, within the next few days?
There is nothing that needs to happen.
I've written to Lord Illingworth to tell him to marry you.
Marry me?
I will force him to do it. The wrong that has been done to you must be repaired. Atonement must be made. Justice may be slow, mother, but it comes in the end. In a few days' time, you shall be Lord Illingworth's lawful wife.
But Gerald!
I will insist upon him doing it. I will dare not refuse.
But Gerald, it is I who refuse. I will not marry Lord Illingworth.
Not marry him? Mother, you don't understand. It is for your sake I talk, not mine. This marriage, which must take place, does not help me. It will not give me a name that is really rightly mine to bear, but it will do something for you, that you, my mother, should, however late, become the wife of the man who is my father. Is that not something?
I will not marry him.
Mother, you must.
I will not. You talk of atonement for wrong done. What atonement can be made to me? I am disgraced. He is not. That is all. It is the usual history of a man and a woman, as it usually happens, as it always happens. And the ending is the ordinary ending. The woman suffers, the man goes free.
I don't think that is the ordinary ending, Mother. I certainly hope it is not. Your life, at any rate, will not end like that. The man shall make whatever reparation is possible. It does not wipe out the past, I know that, but it makes the future better. Better for you, Mother.
I refuse to marry Lord Illingworth.
Mother, if he came here and asked you to marry him himself, you would give him a different answer. Remember, he is my father.
If he came here himself, which he will not do, my answer would be the same. Remember, I am your mother.
You make it terribly difficult for me by talking like that. It is to take away the bitterness out of your life. Take away the shadow that lies over your name, but this marriage must take place. After you are married, you and I can go away together. But this marriage must take place first. It is a duty that you owe, not merely to yourself, but to all other women, lest you betray more.
I owe nothing to other women. There is not one woman to whom I could go for pity, if I were to take it, or for sympathy. I could win it. Women are hard on one another. That girl last night, good though she is, fled from the room as though I were a tainted thing. She's right, I am a tainted thing. But my wrongs are my own, and I will bear them alone.
I implore you to do what I ask of you.
What son has ever asked of his mother so hideous a sacrifice? None.
What mother has ever refused to marry the father of her own child? None.
Let me be the first, then. I will not do it.
Mother, you believe in religion, and you brought me up to believe in it also. Well, surely your religion must tell you that I am right. You know it, you feel it.
I do not know it. I do not feel it, nor will I ever stand before God's altar and ask God's blessing on so hideous a mockery as a marriage between me and George Hartman. How could I swear to love the man I loathe, to honour him who brought you dishonour, to obey him who in his mastery made me to sin? No, marriage is a sacrifice. Those who love each other. Gerald, to save you from the world's sneers and taunts, I have lied to the world. But not for my own sake will I lie to God and in God's presence. No, Gerald, no ceremony, church hallowed or state made, shall ever bind me to George Harford. May be that I am too bound to him already, who, robbing me, yet left me richer. So that in the mire of my life, I found the pearl of price.
don't understand you now.
Ben, don't understand what mothers are. I am no different from other women, except in the wrong dummy and the wrong I did. And yet, to bear you, I had to look on death. All women must fight with death to keep their children. Gerald, when you were naked, I clothed you. When you were hungry, I gave you food. And oh, how I loved you. And you needed love, for you were weakly. And only love could keep you alive. Only love can keep anyone alive. Boys are careless, and without thinking cause pain. The world draws them from our side. You made many friends, Gerald, and went into their houses and were glad of them. And I, knowing my secret, did not dare to follow, but stayed inside and closed the door, shut out the sun and sat in darkness. And you thought I didn't care for the pleasant things of life. I tell you, I longed for them, but did not dare to touch them, feeling that I had no right. You thought I was happier working amongst the poor. It was my mission, you imagined. It was not, but where else was I to go? The sick do not ask if the hand that smooths their pillow is pure, nor the dying care if the lips that touch their brow have known the kiss of sin. And you thought I spent too much of my time in going to church and church duties. But where else was I to turn? God's house is the only house where sinners are made welcome. And you were always in my heart, Gerald. Too much in my heart. For though I have knelt at morn and at evensong, day after day in God's house, I have never repented of my sin. How could I repent of my sin when you, my love, were its fruit? Don't you see? It is my disgrace that has made you so dear to me. It is my dishonor that has bound you so closely to me. It is the price I pay for you, the price of soul and body that makes me love you as I do. Don't ask me to do this horrible thing. Child of my shame, be still the child of my shame.
Mother, I never knew you loved me as much as that. And I promise I will try to be a better son than I have been. And you and I must never leave each other. But Mother, I can't help it. You must marry him.
No! No, you shall not! That would be real dishonor. The first you have ever known. That would be real disgrace, the first to ever touch you. Leave him and come with me. There are other countries than England. Other countries overseas that are better, wiser, and less unjust lands. The world is very wide and very big.
Not for me. For me, the world is shriveled to a palm's breadth, and where I walk, there are thorns.
It shall not be so. Together we will find green valleys and fresh water. And if we weep, well, we will weep together. Have we not both loved him? Don't! You cannot love me if you do not love her also. You cannot honor me if she is not holier to you. In her, all womanhood is martyred.
Esther, what shall I do?
Do you respect the man that is your father?
Respect him? I despise him. The man is infamous.
I thank you for saving me from him last night.
But that was nothing. I would die to save you. But you don't tell me what to do now.
Do I not thank you for saving me?
What shall I do?
Ask your own heart, not mine. I've never had a mother to save.
hard. Let me go away.
Mother, forgive me. I have been to blame.
Don't kiss my hands. They are cold. My heart is cold. Something has broken in.
Don't say that. Hearts live by being wounded. Pleasure may turn a heart to stone. Riches may make it callous, but sorrow, sorrow cannot break it. Besides, what sorrows have you now? At this moment, you are more dear to him than ever. Oh, be kind to him.
You are my mother and father all in one. I have no need of a second parent. It was for you I spoke and you alone. Mother, say something. Don't tell me I have found the one love to lose another. Oh, Mother, you are cruel.
Loved him always.
But we are very poor.
Oh, who being loved is poor? No one. I hate my riches. They're a burden. Let him share them.
But we are disgraced. We rank among the outcasts. Gerald is nameless. The sins of the parents shall be visited on the children. It is God's law.
I was wrong. God's only law is love.
Gerald, I cannot bring you a father, but I have brought your wife.
Mother, I am not worthy of either her or you.
So she comes first. You are worthy. And when you're away, Gerald, with her, think of me sometimes. Don't forget me. And when you pray, pray for me. We should pray when we are happiest, and you will be happy, Gerald.
You don't think of leaving us?
Mother, you won't leave us.
I might bring shame upon you.
Mother!
Well, for a little then. And if you let me near you always.
Come out with us to the garden.
Later on.
A gentleman to see you, sir.
Say I'm not at home. Oh, show me the car. Say I will not see him.
Rachel, Gerald knows everything about you and me now. So some arrangement must be come to that will suit us all three. I assure you he'll find me the most charming and generous of fathers.
My son may come in at any moment. I saved you from him last night. I may not be able to do so again. My son feels my dishonor strongly, terribly strongly. I beg you to go.
Last night was excessively unfortunate. That silly Puritan girl making a scene merely because I wanted to kiss her. I mean, what harm is there in a kiss?
A kiss may ruin a human life, George Harford. I know that. I know that too well.
We won't discuss that at present. What is of importance today, as yesterday, is still our son. I'm extremely fond of him, as you know, and, well, odd though it may seem to you, I admired his conduct last night immensely. He took up the cudgels for that pretty prude with wonderful promptitude. He is just what I would have liked a son of mine to be. Except that no son of mine should ever take the side of Puritans, that is always a mistake. Now, what I propose is this.
Lord Illingworth, no proposition of yours interests.
According to our ridiculous English laws, I can't legitimise Gerald, but I can leave him my property. Illingworth is entailed, of course, but it's a tedious barrack of a place. He can have Ashley, which is much prettier, Harborough, which has the best shooting in the north of England, and the house in St. James's Square. What more could a gentleman require in the world?
Oh, nothing more, I'm quite sure.
Yeah, as for a title? Well, a title is rather a nuisance in these democratic days. As George Harford, I had everything I wanted. Whereas now, I just have everything other people want, and that isn't nearly so pleasant. Well, what I propose is this.
I told you I was interested, and I beg you to go.
The boy is to be with you for 6 months of the year, and with me for the other 6. That's perfectly fair, is it not? You can have whatever allowance you like, live wherever you choose. As for your past, well, nobody knows anything about that except myself and Gerald. Well, there is the Puritan, of course, but she doesn't count. You couldn't very well tell the story without explaining she objected to being kissed, and then all the women would think her a fool, all the men think her a bore. And you needn't be afraid that Gerald won't be my heir. I need hardly tell you I haven't the slightest intention of ever marrying him.
You come too late. My boy has no need of you. You're not necessary.
What do you mean, Rachel?
You're not necessary to Gerald's career. He does not require you.
I do not understand you.
Look into the garden. Don't let him see you bring unpleasant memories. She loves him. They love each other. We are safe from you and we are going away.
Where?
We will not tell you. And if you find us, we will not know you. You seem surprised. What welcome will you get from the girl whose lips you tried to soil? From the boy whose life you have shamed? From the mother whose dishonor comes from you?
Oh, you have grown hard, Rachel.
I was too weak once. It is well for me that I have changed.
I was very young at the time. We men know life too early.
Oh, and women know life too late. That is the difference between men and women.
Rachel, I want my son. My money may be of no use to him now. I may be of no use to him now. But I want my son. Bring us together, Rachel. You can do it if you choose.
There is no room in my boy's life for you. He's not interested in you.
Well then, why does he write it to me?
What do you mean?
What letter is this?
That is nothing.
It is
Give it to me.
It's addressed to me.
You're not to open it. I forbid you to open it.
And in Gerald's handwriting.
It is a letter he wrote this morning before he spoke with me. But he's sorry now he wrote it, very sorry. Give it to me.
It belongs to me. You've read this letter, I suppose, Rachel.
No.
But you know what's in it.
Yes.
I don't admit for a moment the boy's right in what he says, but, well, to get my son back, I am ready, yes, I am ready to marry you, Rachel, and treat you always with the deference and respect due to my wife. I will marry you just as soon as you choose. I give you my word of honour.
You gave me that word once before and broke it.
I will keep it now, and that will show to you that I love my son just as much as you do. For after all, when I marry you, there are some ambitions I shall have to surrender. High ambitions at that, if any ambition.
I decline to marry you, Lord Illingworth.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Well, do tell me your reasons. They would interest me in your ones.
I've already explained them to my son.
I suppose they were intensely sentimental, were they? You women live by your emotions and for them.
You are right. We women live by our emotions and for them. By our passions and for them, if you will. I have two passions, Lord Illingworth. My love of him and my hate of you. You cannot kill these. They feed each other.
What love is that that needs that hate of his brother?
It is the kind of love I have for Gerald. Do you think that is terrible? Well, it is terrible. All love is terrible. All love is a tragedy. I loved you once, Lord Illingworth. Oh, what a tragedy for a woman to have loved you.
So you really refuse to marry her?
Yes.
Because you hate me?
Yes.
Does my son hate me as you do?
No.
Oh, I'm glad of that, Rachel.
He merely despises you.
What a pity. Oh, what a pity for him, I mean.
Don't be deceived, George. Children begin by loving their parents. After a time, they forgive them. Rarely, if ever, do they forgive them.
May I ask by what arguments you made the boy who wrote this letter, this beautiful, passionate letter, believe that you should not marry Is father the father of your own child?
It was not I who made him see it. It was another.
Oh, what fan de siècle person.
The Puritan, Lord Everywhere.
Then there's not much for me to do here, Rachel.
Nothing.
It's goodbye, isn't it?
Forever this time, I hope, Lord Everywhere.
How curious. At this moment, you look to me as you looked the night you left me 20 years ago. You have that same expression in your mouth. Hold my word, Rachel. No woman ever loved me as much as you did. Why, you gave yourself to me like a flower, to do whatever I pleased. You were the prettiest of playthings, the most fascinating of small romances. Quarter to two. Must be strolling back to Hunston. But don't suppose I'll see you there again. I'm sorry. I am, really. Yeah. It's been the most amusing experience. To meet among people of one's own rank, and treated quite seriously, too. One's mistress and one.
No importance.